I'd like to show you all the pictures. It was one of those things where you just say, "How blessed you are." Sitting at the breakfast table, said, "Lumpy grits."
Okay, we're back in session, and I guess you have what's up next, there, Doctor?
Second countdown.
Second. Countdown. We've got a countdown.
I have to repeat that.
All right. Start. Let me wait for our end. We're back in session, Doctor Woodruff. If you want to continue.
Yes, Mayor and Council, what we'd like to do now is talk a few minutes about planning and building and code enforcement and community development. Reggie is with us, as with his staff. If you look in your paper budget, it's page 92. On your iPad, it is page 95. You'll notice that this is a department that has development review fees, and you'll notice that they are going down. That is a realization that the economy is turning down regarding permitting and development. Likewise, it is a reflection of the fact that you have made certain policy changes where many things that used to require a fee and an application are now handled administratively or handled through a different process that you review. In the budget notes for planning and administration, you will notice on note number 2 that the staff estimates the total number of permits and building plans for FY14 will be about 3,500. And using permit averages for the last several years, we project that that's going to stay about 3,500. Most of those, though, are going to be commercial inspections, and therefore you're going to see a lot more inspections per facility. If you had a lot of single-family homes, you don't have nearly as many inspections per location. But when you're dealing with commercial establishments, which we're blessed to have a lot of commercial growth still going on, that's where Danny and his folks will be doing a lot of the inspection area. You will also see that in this overall area, there are 11 personnel, and you will also see that that includes everybody that has to do with the development review process. That's your planning personnel, that's the folks who are reviewing the building permits. It does not include fire personnel who may review it, and it does not include the inspectors themselves. Not much change to this budget at all. Actually, there was a decline, but that decline was primarily due to debt service. Any questions in this area?
So you're saying the number of inspections based on commercial development will probably maintain the same pace for next fiscal year as this year?
Yes, sir. And that's because of the commercial growth. Now, we know there are going to be very few permits issued for multiple family, and therefore almost no inspections. We know that we are looking at about 50 single-family homes, if the projection stays about right. That's down from over 100 several years ago. Those inspections, you know, for a typical single-family home, you may be out there a dozen times, but for a commercial establishment, you could be there 20 or 30 times or more, depending on the size of the facility.
Do we have that information available in terms of number of inspections, commercial, residential, over the last couple of years?
Yes, sir. We can get that for you. And we'll show you over the build-up period what that looked like. If you look in building inspections, this is an area that you are continuing to see a decline in fees. We are projecting this year about $50,000 less in fees than last year. The thing that I would ask you to remember is that when a permit is issued, that's when the fee is paid. From the time that the permit is issued until the time the actual work begins can be 3 or 4 months, and on a commercial building, you could see that last for several months, if not a year or more. And I'll give you an example. You remember Tony's Seafood up on Western Boulevard? Mm-hmm. That building received this building permit, I would guess, about 15 months ago. It still has not received any certificate of occupancies. And Danny and his folks have been up there, you know, once a week, 2 or 3 times a week. It just spreads out because of the pace. On the other hand, you may have a development where you have a, Ron is saying change the slide, so we'll put you in charge of that. You may have another development such as a bank or a restaurant where they get in and they complete that project within a very short period of time. Another example, two of the hotels that are under construction up on Western Boulevard, one behind Cheddar's and one behind the Longhorns, I believe it is, Steakhouse. Those projects, I am not being critical, but I think they drive 1 or 2 nails a day just to keep their building permits active. So you may go weeks between inspections there. So there is no direct timeline between when a permit is paid versus when the inspections occur. Right now we're seeing a significant drag, a significant extension of those inspections. But again, if building continues like it is, that inspection fee number of $600,000, which is $50,000 less than this current year, we may see that drop even lower.
I might add, Richard, that as of to date, we have brought in $512,000 of fees, which is 79%. Of what we thought we would bring in. At the end of the month, we should have about, if we on target, we would have about 84%. So if we pick up that 5% and continue, we could get closer to $650,000 this year. Over the last 13 years, as if you remember, Ryan gave a presentation on fees, we're averaging about $600,000 on building fees over the last 13 years. So we may come close to it. We're hoping that the pace will keep going as it's been going and pick up a little bit, and we may get close to that $650,000.
The rumor that we have waived the building permit fee for the Krispy Kreme is only a rumor, and that's because they haven't come in for their permit yet. Now, you can see in the building inspections, we're staying with 7 personnel. You can also see that a lot of this has to do with the codes that continue to be. Note number 2, increase in expenditure line item 2 is due to increases in subscriptions and ITS specific charges. I want to assure you those subscriptions are not to the local newspaper, although we appreciate their service. And I can assure you that they're not to Southern Living, where we can look at new house designs. They are subscriptions to the North Carolina International Code Cycle books, which we have to purchase every 3 years, and also, as you can see, increased charges for SunGuard. One of the things that you did 2 years ago is you approved the purchase of a e-plan system. We have found that that is not utilized as heavily as we would like. One of the policy decisions that we're going to be discussing with you, but not part of the budget, is to move away from paper and make the e-submittals mandatory except for owner-occupied improvements. But we will, we're not asking you to make a decision on that today. But you had an investment of $180,000. And we need to make sure that the folks who we made that investment for are taking advantage of it. Because I can assure you that if they file with the E-plan, there is substantial savings. That savings may not be there for a single family home, but for anything larger, it would certainly be true. Any questions on inspections? Code enforcement, you will notice again a modest, you know, increase in this budget overall. I will tell you, code enforcement is that area where on Saturday afternoon when a furniture dealer calls the mayor and says, I've got liquidation signs out in front of my business on 24, that's not fair because they're taking business away. Within 4 hours, a code enforcement person was out there getting those signs up. You know, it would be nice if we did not need code enforcement at all. But on the other hand, you know, you get complaints, we get complaints about what we would call unfair advertising practices, because it is technically illegal to put those signs out there. And believe me, when 2-3 weeks ago we collected almost 100 signs from one business and then went and visited that person and said, you can't do this, would you like to know what their response was?
We're closing anyway.
Well, they did say that too. You know, part of our issue with sign enforcement is that the law is not on our side. And until we come up with more stringent ways of encouraging people not to do negative things, we will basically be in the enforcement business by what I will call removal, not regulation. And there's nothing wrong with that. You know, y'all understand why we are out there doing that, and almost every weekend we have a person out there and we stagger schedules so we hold down overtime. Some of your other code enforcement activities though are where we are doing nuisance abatement, and I'll give you an example there. A house is currently vacant. It has an out-of-town owner. The grass is up 3 feet tall and we can't get them to cut it. Well, we cut it. We also file a lien on their property. Will we ever get that money back? Hopefully we will. But that's why you have the roughly $20,000 in there for nuisance abatement.
I thought it was added to their property taxes.
It is.
Okay,
plus
it's not a lien.
$200 administration fee. Yeah. Okay. We will get it back.
We will get it back.
Get it.
Large part of it.
Is this something like a one-time deal, or can it be multiple times that you go out and mow the lawn for the appearances?
Oh, in many cases, it's multiple times.
Okay.
And we have some locations here in town where, because the law does allow us to go, once we have gone through the full process of notifying, we can then go to a shorter process, where we have some residences where we will mow the property 4 or 5 times during the summer. And we do that mowing through contracts where we send out bids and the low bidder gets the mowing operation. Community development will be the last one that we'd like to cover this evening if we can. As you know, the community development block grant money has continued to decline. At one point, Reggie, we were receiving what, over $600,000?
Over $600,000, yeah. And it was almost cut by 25% 1 year, and it's been cut since, and we've cut about $5,000 this year.
So we've gone from over $600,000 to about $365,000. The important thing, though, is the program has lasted long enough where it now has program income. And so the concept is that it will create enough income to allow itself to be self-funding at one day. But you can see the program income this year is about $182,000. And we try to invest that money into the very best ways of removing slum and blight. That's one of our number one target areas. And of course, in the lower income neighborhoods, helping home ownership. So.
Do we have any new homes slated for downtown for building more affordable houses, or is that kind of on hold because of the decrease in the development block grants?
Richie, you want to answer that?
As you know, we have built four homes down there with the private sector, and we plan on continuing that program again. What we did last time we did it, we built the homes up front, and then we tried to find the people that qualify for the homes. That took a little longer to sell than we wanted, so we are tweaking the process this time. We're trying to get the people qualified first, let them come in, pick out their lot, pick out what type of building plan they want, and then the builder would build it, and hopefully we'll get it sold faster that way. So yes, we do continue to have that plan, that program in the future downtown.
And we don't believe that the reduction in federal funds is going to hurt that program. What is hurting that program right now, though, is the credit score. The state of North Carolina has a down payment assistance program that used to have a credit score of 580. They raised this credit score to 620, and I believe at one time 640?
640.
Yeah. What that really means is that a whole lot of people who could have qualified for a fixed loan, 30-year fixed loan at a 580 or 600 or 610 score, they can't meet a 640 score. So our number one problem right now is not funding availability. There are loans that are available. There are builders who want to build the houses, and the city has the lots. The number one challenge we have is that down payment assistance program from the state. When Lily brings to you the five-year plan coming up, one of the things we're going to be discussing with you is using some of our program income for down payment assistance. And with that, we can set the credit score at 600 or 610 or 580, whatever number you're comfortable with. But again, that's a discussion that you'll have in several weeks when she brings to you the next five-year plan.
Program income. Yeah. A couple years ago, we had a stellar record in terms of very low number of failures to repay. Is that continuing?
That is continuing on the home ownership side, but we've seen some defaults recently have been deaths of the homeowners. We've had some.
In what place?
Deaths. Senior deaths. Citizens that have had their homes rehabbed. We've actually acquired two properties through deed in lieu of foreclosure where the homeowners have died and the heirs cannot agree on refinancing that loan with the city, where we've taken those properties back. So that's happened twice. But where they have died, we work real, real close with the family. Try to find somebody that can take over that loan to avoid that from happening.
The program revenue had a real high budget number in 14. Is that going to pan out, or is it just we're going down again to 181?
Well, what happened there is we were able to sell a house that we had for a number of years.
So
we had that one-time splurge in revenue. So you will not see that again unless we have some property for sale. And let's discuss that a second. We have several lots that we may decide that we want to market rather than build homes on. Why? Because we've actually had private builders who've come in and said, would you sell us this lot? We don't want it to be part of the housing program. Some of those lots we think may be a good idea. And I'll give you an example. Over where Saunders Funeral Home is, Lily, what's the road there?
Cavernous Drive.
We have looked for the possibility of building some homes in there through our public-private partnership. We haven't found much interest. On the other hand, we have found a property owner who would be interested in building. Our concern there is, are they going to, our concern in that case will they build a rental home or will they build a home occupied home, an owner occupied home? Those are details that we'd have to work with you. But again, that spike had to do with selling a home. I would also, you know, in closing this evening, I would say to you that, you know, this is a department, community development, you should be extremely proud of what they have done in the last number of years to change the appearance of Jacksonville. You can't ride around downtown Jacksonville and see the same city. You can't ride Country Club and see the same city. The number of houses that they are tearing down in conjunction with your streets department and with your code enforcement and building inspectors, that's exemplary. So very good work. If you're comfortable, next week we're going to focus into public works. We'll be out of the general fund for a while, and then we'll get into some real hard discussions about 3 weeks away.
If we're not comfortable, you'll probably still subject us to going through that.
Anybody have anything?
Motion to adjourn.
Second.
Any discussion? Hearing none, all in favor, signify by saying aye.
Aye.